Good evening, guys. Welcome. Today we are going to be talking about law of contract, and I need to again bring to your notice how relevant this subject is as far as any of the law entrances are concerned. Even if we take the example of CLAT, okay, which is one of the most sought after law entrances, you know that of the 50 questions that are dedicated to the legal aptitude section, almost 35 come from the area of principal fact questions. And just for your clarity, principal fact questions happen to be those questions where under the principal category, they will quote a law for you, and of course, they'll give you a factual situation. So your task is to apply that principle to the factual situation and mark the correct option. And contract happens to be one of the most dominant areas other than IPC and contract as far as the principal fact questions are concerned. So if you have basic concept clarity about a few aspects under the law of contract, you are going to be able to score really well in the legal aptitude section. Also, for all those who do not know, legal aptitude section is the tiebreaker section in CLAT. So your edge in this section might fetch you your sought after seat in the dream college. So let me give you a brief introduction about the law of contract. This law was framed back in 1872. So just like the Indian Penal Code, it is a pre-independence law, and the Indian Contract Act is basically based on the maxim of pacta sunt servanda, which means that pacts must be kept. Now, ideally, in our day-to-day lives, you know, we enter into several contracts. Even when you visit a shop and buy a packet of chips, that's an example of a contract. To the fact when you enter into a contract with your landlord, or the contract which takes place between the employer and his employee, a landlord and a tenant, or the fact that your favorite cricketer or footballer signs a contract with a football club or an IPL team. All of these are examples of contract. So contracts tend to sort of dominate our lives these days because our agreements have been formalized. Right. So today we are going to try to get a better understanding and clarity as to how contracts are entered into, what are the several types of contracts, and how your free consent is really important when you make an offer or an acceptance while entering into a contract. And we'll see what are the several do's and don'ts of a contract. So are we good to start the session? All right, great. So the very first slide on your screens says that A is making an offer to B that he is willing to sell his house to B for a sum of about 10 lakh rupees. A is the offerer in this case and B is the offeree. Now we need to understand certain basic aspects of a contract. Let's look at the first slide. Now when A is making this statement that he is willing to sell his house to B for the amount of rupees 10 lakh, he is specifying two things, or he is making two things absolutely clear. What are those two things? The first thing is what A is willing to do. A is willing to sell his house to B for rupees 10 lakh. And what is A expecting B to do in return? He is expecting B to pay that sum of rupees 10 lakh. What is important here is the maxim consensus ad idem. Consensus ad idem means meeting of minds. That means when an offer is made and an acceptance is made, there has to be meeting of minds. Both the parties, that is the party making the offer and the party which is making the acceptance, they should be agreeing upon the same thing in the same manner. So when A says that he is willing to sell his house for rupees 10 lakh, B has to agree to it in the same manner. That is, if he should be willing to buy the same house for the same amount of money. Even if he makes a slight deviation, say for example, B says that I'm not going to buy this house, I'm going to buy the other house. Or if he says I'm not going to buy it for 10 lakh, I'll buy it for 9.5 lakh. Then this becomes a counter offer instead of becoming an acceptance. Let's proceed. So we have to understand the difference between an agreement and a contract. Now, in our day-to-day lives, we enter into several agreements. When you decide to go for a movie with a friend, that's an example of an agreement. But not every agreement is given the status of a contract as per the Indian Contract Act of 1872. So it is our job, most importantly, to understand what is that defining factor which will give the status of a contract to an agreement. Now, when you ask your friend to go for a movie, you make an offer, and when your friend accepts it, he or she is making an acceptance. So offer and acceptance lead to an agreement. But chances are your friend might cancel out on the plan. So can you take your friend to the court or file a case against your friend because he or she did not turn up for the movie or he or she cancelled last minute? You can't do so because it is a social agreement, and social agreements way different from a contract. Now, let's take a look at this slide and let's try to understand what is that differentiating or defining factor. Contracts are based on agreements. So that means every contract definitely will have offer and acceptance, right? So what is that defining factor which is transforming a social agreement into a contract? It is that sense of legal obligation. What do you understand by legal obligation? Legal obligation basically means a legal duty. Okay, so when the other party is under the legal bounden or legal duty to fulfill their part of the promise or their part of the contract, that is legal obligation. Because I told you when I was introducing law of contract to you that law of contract is basically based on the concept that promises should be honored or pacts must be kept. So till the time two parties are fulfilling their respective promises, there is not going to be a problem. But the minute one of the parties fails to fulfill his or her part of the promise, there's definitely going to be a problem. And that is where you need to involve a legal authority, or that is when you need to approach a court. So legal obligation is that legal duty. So when you attach this aspect of legal obligation, you basically convey to the other party that if you do not fulfill your part of the promise, you might involve a third party, that is a court, to make sure that the promise is fulfilled. Alright, Sumit ma'am, what if in pursuance of the agreement a friend bought a ticket? Then what is the status? Sumit, these are social agreements, and wherever there's a case of blood relatives or friends or relations of natural love and affection, the court will assume that there was no intention to create a legal obligation. So you might have bought a ticket for the friend, but there is an inherent assumption that your intention was not to drag your friend to the court in case he or she did not turn up. Okay, so I'll repeat it again. In the following categories, the court will simply assume that there was no intention to create a legal relationship. The first category is husband and wife. Second category is any other blood relatives. And third category is all those relationships where there is natural love and affection. Right? Let's move further. What is legal obligation and how does legal obligation affect the status of an agreement? If you take a look at this slide, wherever there's an agreement, now agreement's basic elements are offer and acceptance. Now, what is that additional agreement which will give it the status of a contract? Legal obligation. We've already discussed what legal obligation is. But wherever there's an agreement and social obligation. So social obligation, the example would be when you invite friends for dinner, or you make a plan for going out for a movie, or you tell your friend to wait for you before the class starts. All these are social agreements, and you do not intend to involve a legal authority in case the other party does not fulfill their part of the promise. So whenever there's agreement and a social obligation or a social duty, it will not be a contract. So you have to make sure that in any of the law entrances and the principal fact questions, the paper setters are most likely going to judge you on this very aspect. They are going to throw a situation at you which involves a social obligation, like going for a dinner, going for a movie, and they might confuse you further by saying, like one of you asked that what if somebody had already bought a ticket, etc., etc. Then they might put you in that spot where you're forced to go for the wrong option, where you might feel, okay, if somebody's bought a ticket or if someone's prepared dinner, then the other person should be made liable. So students, please keep this in mind that it will still remain a social agreement and it will not become a legal contract. Clear? So I've already explained this to you that agreement basically just comprises of two elements, offer and acceptance. Now agreement or for a contract, you need at least two people or two parties, because you cannot be in agreement with yourself. You need one outside party to agree with. So a minimum of two parties are really important for an agreement. And whenever you enter into an agreement, you have an ultimate objective, purpose or motive in mind. So there has to be a specific purpose behind every agreement or contract. And every agreement needs to specify the rights and duties between such persons. So whenever two people decide to do something, say for example, an employer hires an employee, so he tells or he specifies exactly what the employee is expected to do, and in return the employer also specifies what is the kind of salary he is going to pay. So the duties and obligations are specified when an agreement is made. Now we are going to move on to the elements of a contract, but before that I'd like to know if there's any query. Anshuman, today we are only going to be taking questions related to contract. Okay, conversion is specifically related to torts, which we are going to be taking up in the forthcoming lectures. Aditya, counter offer is, I'll give you an example, that if A makes an offer to B, say for example that I am going to sell you my house for 10 lakh rupees. So instead of saying that okay, I'm going to buy your house for 10 lakh rupees, you say that I'm going to buy your house for 9.5 lakh rupees. Now you're not accepting his offer, instead you are making him an offer. So that is why it is a counter offer and not and acceptance. Clear? Okay, the best example of cross offer is when both the parties make an offer at the same time. So cross offer literally means that the offers cross each other. Okay, two parties make an offer pertaining to the same subject matter at the same time. That is what you mean by cross offer. And there are a lot of overlapping features as far as counter offer and cross offer are concerned. So most popularly we use the term counter offer now. Okay, because the chances of cross offer are really, really dim most of the times. Alright, I will be explaining invitation to offer in the forthcoming slides. Anshuman, the difference between contingent and wagering contract. See, most importantly, a wagering contract is void. Okay, it is not allowed as per the Indian Contract Act. So the best example of a wagering contract would be betting. I'm sure you all are aware of how people bet on sports. Okay, cricket betting has been a huge scandal, a controversial issue. So betting is the best example of a wagering contract where people bet that if Sachin Tendulkar is going to score 100 in this match, then they win a certain amount of money. So it's like gamble, and wagering contracts are void. However, the example of a contingent contract would be the insurance policies that you buy. Say for example, you buy an insurance policy and for your car. So in the event, if your car gets damaged or if your car gets stolen, that is when you're going to get a certain amount of money. So contingent contract depends on the certain happening or non-happening of an event. However, wagering contract is illegal, and it is that situation where two parties decide that a certain incident which is completely unrelated to them, if that happens, then either one of them is going to win a certain amount of money. Alright, so now I'm moving on to the elements of a contract. Before I start explaining to you the elements of a contract, I'd like to tell you that in the forthcoming slides, I'm going to be talking about a valid contract. And when I'm going to tell you what a valid contract is, you must remember all these elements, because a valid contract consists of all these elements. So I'm going to start with the first element of a valid contract. The first element is there have to be at least a minimum of two parties. I told you in the previous slides also that for any agreement, okay, you have to have two parties. One that makes the offer and the other party that accepts the offer. And it is on this first feature that consensus ad idem is based, that is meeting of minds. Consensus ad idem is also very important from examination point of view. You can expect a direct question on the meaning of this maxim, consensus ad idem, since the entire law of contract is based on this one maxim. The second point is intention to create a legal relationship. So what they're really talking about is two parties should have that intention of creating a formal relationship. That is the only way we'll be able to differentiate it from a social agreement. right? So legal relationship, people should know that this is a formal agreement, not an informal social agreement. And in case either of the parties don't fulfill the agreement, legal consequences might follow. Lawful object. It's really essential, because I told you, whenever two people enter into an agreement, that is, one party makes an offer, the other party makes an acceptance, they have an ultimate purpose or objective in mind all the time. And this ultimate purpose or objective has to be lawful. Now, two parties may enter into a contract, but the ultimate objective might be to deal in drugs or might be to get a third party killed. So that will be an unlawful objective. Then, capacity of parties. Capacity of parties is threefold. We are looking at the mental capacity, we are looking at the capacity that is age-wise, and finally we are looking at legal capacity. So you'll keep this in mind. Three types of capacities: mental capacity, then we're talking about the age-wise capacity, and legal capacity. As far as mental capacity is concerned, a person has to have a sound mind. Okay, if you have an unsound mind, you cannot enter into a contract. Why so? Because again, I'm going to take you back to consensus ad idem. If there cannot be meeting of minds if the person is unsound, that means he does not understand the implications of the terms and conditions he's signing up for. Clear? The second thing is, you have to be 18 years or above. For the purpose of the Indian Contract Act, the age of majority is 18 years. So if you're below 18 years of age, you cannot enter into a contract. Even if you do that, it's going to be void. Finally, we are talking about legal capacity. So if you are somebody who is an insolvent is someone who cannot fulfill his financial obligations or financial duties. Somebody who's an insolvent is usually declared bankrupt. Okay. And if you're an insolvent, you can't enter into a contract. The second thing is, if you are facing jail time, okay, if you are undergoing imprisonment, of course you can't enter into a contract. And the third thing is, you cannot enter into a contract with an enemy alien. Enemy alien means a citizen of a country with whom India has declared war. Okay, and also you cannot enter into a contract with a foreign diplomat or an ambassador without the permission of the central government. So these are the people who are disqualified by law, and you cannot enter into a contract with them. Alright, the next point is free consent. So the party that is making the offer and the party that is accepting that offer, their consent has to be absolutely free. If your consent is not free, it is definitely going to affect the validity of your contract. Because keep this point in mind. In the forthcoming slides, I'm going to be talking about free consent and how it makes a contract voidable. So your consent or your will has to be absolutely free when you're making the offer, as well as when you're making the acceptance. We'll also be discussing in detail that what are those factors which tend to interfere with an individual's free consent. The next point on the slide is certainty or clear terms. Again, I'll have to mention the maxim consensus ad idem, which means meeting of minds. So the terms and conditions of your contract have to be absolutely clear. There has to be perfect clarity. So if A is saying, I'm going to sell you my house for rupees 10 lakh, okay, he has to be very clear about which house, in which city, which location, and the exact amount of money. In case A says that I'm going to sell you my house for the best market price. Now this term, best market price, is uncertain. It is very subjective. It can fluctuate with every passing day. Right, the best market price can be different for the buyer, and it's definitely going to be different for the seller. Clear? So certainty is really important. The next thing is possibility of performance. Alright, it's very essential to enter into a contract with those terms and conditions which are possible to perform. You cannot enter into a contract which is impossible to perform. Now understand one thing, there is impossibility of two types. Some things are impossible from the very onset. That means the minute you enter into a contract, you know that this cannot be performed. Say for example, I make an offer to the other party and say, okay, I am going to bring back your dead dog to life if you pay me this amount of money. Now I am defying the rules of nature when I say this. This is not possible. Right, to bring back a dead animal to life. This is inherently impossible. That means impossible right from the start. But the second kind of impossibilities which may occur later. Now say for example, you enter into a contract with a singer who's supposed to perform at a family function of yours. Now chances are that the singer falls ill or due to some reason cannot be present at that certain date when the function was scheduled. Now, if he falls ill, there is nobody else who can perform this contract for him. So now this is an impossibility which has arisen later. So possibility of performance is very important. Anshuman, again, today I am only taking queries as far as law of contract is concerned. I am not discussing intellectual property rights. We'll be discussing this in the forthcoming sections. So I'm requesting all of you, please make sure you're only putting out queries related to law of contract. Clear? Yes, Shraddha, what's your question? I just clarified cross offer for you. Shraddha, you do have other sessions. You have 3 more sessions to go as far as legal aptitude is concerned. We'll be sending you emails and messages whenever they are scheduled. Alright? The next point is consideration. So when A tells B that I am going to sell my house to you for rupees 10 lakh, consideration happens to be that value addition for both the parties. Okay, so for A, the value addition is going to be those 10 lakh rupees that he is going to get after selling his house, and for B, consideration is the house that he is going to get after giving 10 lakh rupees. So consideration means something of value. When you enter into a contract, there has to be some value addition for you. Please pay attention to this point that whenever value addition is only for one person, okay? When I give you this example of the sale of a house, both the parties are benefiting, right? But say for example, A told B that I'm going to give you my house. In this case, B is not paying any money. So this is either going to be a gift or charity. So until and unless both the parties to the contract are not benefiting, you cannot call it a contract. And of course, the last point on the slide is legal obligation. I've told you the most important aspect is that you have to create a legal duty for each other. So in this case, when A tells B that I'm going to sell you my house for rupees 10 lakh, in case A transfers the house and its ownership papers to B, it is the legal duty of B to pay that sum of rupees 10 lakh. In case B fails to do that, then of course the court can be involved and the court will make sure that B fulfills his or her part of the promise, and that part is the payment of rupees 10 lakh. So this is how the concept of legal obligation works. Agreement plus legal obligation, I've clarified again, leads to the formation of a contract. Now, look at this line, it's relevant. All contracts are agreements, but all agreements are not contracts. Because all contracts inherently have the feature of offer and acceptance, right? But all agreements do not have the concept of legal obligation attached to them. That is why we say this, that all contracts are agreements, but all agreements eventually do not culminate into contracts. Any queries? Okay, Purnima, if A asks B, tell me what's the price of your car, I want to buy it. B tells the price to be rupees 2 lakh. A says fine, I will buy. It is a contract or not? Okay, Purnima, this question that you asked is a very good question. Also, it's based on a really famous case law, that is Harvey versus Facy. Now, if you look at this, please focus on the question on the chat that's been put up by Purnima. She's asking that when A asks B that what is the price of your car and I also want to buy your car. So here he's basically asking two questions. What is the price and can I also buy your car or not? The other party simply responds by telling them that the car is going to be for rupees 2 lakh. He has not responded by saying that yes, you can buy the car. So he's only answered one question. And supply of information is never acceptance. We'll be doing that in the forthcoming part of the session. So Purnima, it will not be a contract because he has not answered the second question. That is whether he is willing to sell the car to him or not. Alright, now I am going to proceed to the next part. That is, what are the different types of a contract. Now, mainly, I'm going to be dealing with what is a valid contract, void contract, voidable and unenforceable contract. Now, this is something you need extreme clarity on, because in your law entrances, the principal fact questions, you are not going to be asked the definition of these contracts. Clear? So you have to have conceptual clarity. For any subject matter, IPC, torts or contract, the key is to gain conceptual clarity. So instead of focusing on the definitions of the different types of contracts, focus on what the concept is behind these contracts, because ultimately in your exams, you have to identify whether a contract is void, voidable, valid or unenforceable. Right? So I'll proceed by explaining the first type of contract to you, that is a valid contract. Now, when we were discussing the elements of the contract a while back, I told you to keep one thing in mind, that is all the conditions should be satisfied, okay, of the elements of a valid contract, which were offer and acceptance, then legal obligation, free consent, possibility of performance, certainty of terms, lawful object. So all these elements have to be in place if you want your contract to be called valid. Now, the second important point as far as a valid contract is concerned is that it has to be enforceable. Enforceable means that not only should your contract fulfill all the relevant elements, okay, but when you approach the court to make sure that the other party fulfills its part of the contract, then the court should be able to do that. In the previous slide, I told you that one type of contract is unenforceable contract. So when we'll move on to it, you will understand the relevance of enforceability as an element. All the essential elements of a valid contract might be in place, but there may be a situation when you approach the court is not able to enforce the contract. By enforcement, I mean the court might not be able to make sure that the other party fulfills their part of the promise. So when we will deal with unenforceable contracts, we'll see what are those situations in which, despite of all the valid elements being in place, you still can't get a court to enforce the other party to fulfill its part of the contract. Alright, so if you look at this example, X offers to sell his horse for rupees 5000 to B and B accepts the offer. Now, this is a valid contract. Had B said that I don't want to buy a white horse, I want to buy a black horse, or had B put out the statement that I am going to buy the horse but I'll buy it for 4000, then it would have been a counter offer and not an acceptance. Because the minute B says that I won't buy it for 5000, I'll buy it for 4500, then the ball is in A's court. He can also accept it and he can also refuse it. Alright. Okay, the next type of contract that we are going to deal with is a void contract. Now, void contracts are the contracts which have no existence in the eyes of law. Now, if you look at the first point on the slide, there are two things I've spoken about: void ab initio and void. Void ab initio is a type of contract which is void or which has no existence in the eyes of law right from the very beginning. So when I enter into a contract for the purpose of buying or selling drugs, it is a contract which is void right from the beginning. It has no existence in the eyes of law right from the beginning. And a later situation would be when a contract becomes void at a later stage. That means it loses its existence in the eyes of law at a later stage. Now, I had given you this example, and if you look at the third point on the slide also, whenever there is an impossibility of performance, okay? So, when you hire a singer to perform at a function, it's a completely valid contract. But later on, you know, probably if the singer falls ill or meets with an accident, now it is impossible for him to be present at the venue at that particular date and time. Now, this is a contract which has become impossible later on, and it becomes void at this stage. It was valid till the point the singer was going to perform, but the minute it became impossible for him to perform, we will apply the doctrine of frustration. Okay, that means it is a situation which is beyond the control of either of the parties and it leads to the frustration of the contract. So in this case, the contract was not void ab initio, that is, it was not void right from the beginning, but it became void at a later stage. Alright, then the second situation in which the contract is always going to be void is when the contract is entered into by a minor. Minor means below 18. So, as far as these slides are concerned, just try to keep these points in mind that if this is the situation, the contract will always be void. Clear? And I've already discussed with you that impossibility may be there right from the beginning when I gave you this example that when a party promises the other party that it will bring back a dead horse back to life or a dead dog back to life, that is impossibility right from the beginning. In that case, it's void ab initio. But if the impossibility arises later on, it is a void contract. Clear? And the third type of contract which is always going to be void is a contract that you enter under a mistake. Now, what are the three types of mistakes that can be there? Mistake related to subject matter, related to identity of parties, and related to the nature of promise. Now, please keep this point in mind because when I'm going to be dealing with the section of free consent, I'm going to be talking about the examples and illustrations related to subject matter, identity of parties, and nature of promise. But just remember this, whenever a party is under a mistake of fact, the contract will always be void. Any queries up until this point? The next type of contract is a voidable contract. Now try to understand what this is. Aditya, I'll be explaining identity of parties in my next segment when I'll be dealing with free consent. I'll be giving you explanations and examples related to subject matter, identity of parties, as well as nature of promise. Yes, Kripa, in case of the Indian Contract Act, the age of minority is 18 and below. Okay, so you have to be 18 and if you're below 18, then you cannot enter into a contract. But if you're 18 or above 18, you can enter into a valid contract. Any other questions? All right. So now I'm going to, yes, Purnima. Ma'am, if a ship sinks, the contract about its goods is, now if Purnima, the ship sinks, then it's going to be a mistake of fact. Right? There's a mistake regarding subject matter. Two people have entered into a contract, say for example, regarding the purchase of goods which are on a ship, okay, and which is at sea. Now, if the ship sinks, it is something which is not in the knowledge of either of the parties. So, it is going to make the contract void because again, we are going to apply impossibility of performance and doctrine of frustration over here. Now, I'm going to explain to you what a voidable contract is. Now, understand one thing, that a voidable contract is a contract which is completely valid in the eyes of law until and unless one party approaches the court and proves in the court that at the time when the party gave its offer or acceptance, his consent was not free. Okay, so the most relevant factor here is free consent or free will, which means that consent is a mental element. So until and unless you don't go and prove it in court that your consent was not free when you were making the offer or you were making the acceptance, the agreement is going to be absolutely valid in the eyes of law because all the conditions are going to be fulfilled. So it is for that party to go to the court and approach the court and tell the court that the consent was not free. So that's why I'm saying a voidable contract is a contract which remains valid in the eyes of law until and unless one party chooses to avoid that contract by proving in court that when the party made the offer or acceptance, the party's consent was not free. Let us look at the illustration. Now, the essential element is that free consent is missing. Now, X threatens to kill Y. So, here our key word is threatens. If Y does not sell his house for rupees 1 lakh. Y sells his house. Now in this case, it's very evident that Y's consent was not free because X had threatened to kill Y and X said that I'm going to kill you if you do not transfer, if you do not sell the house to me for rupees 1 lakh. So here his consent is not free because he's acting under a threat. His life is under danger. So if later on Y goes and proves in the court that because X made such a threat, that is why he sold the house, and that made his consent devoid of the element of being free, then it is going to be a voidable contract. So it's going to be valid till Y proves in court that X basically coerced or pressurized Y into selling the house. Clear? The last type of contract is unenforceable contract. Now I told you when we were discussing valid contracts, there were two elements. One was that all the essential elements are in place, and the second element was that it is also enforceable. Now if you look at the slide says that it has all the essential elements of a valid contract. And the twist in the story is that it cannot be enforced by a court of law. What is the factor that makes it impossible for the court to enforce the contract is doctrine of lashes and limitation act of 1963. Now what is this doctrine of lashes? Doctrine of lashes says that the court will not entertain your claim, or the court will not entertain your case or your query if you approach the court after an unreasonable time. This means that, say for example, an employee was not paid his salary for 3 months, okay? So ideally the employee should approach the court as soon as possible and should make sure that the employer pays the salary. Now if the employee decides to approach the court after 6 years, okay? Now this is an unreasonable delay. Until and unless the employee has a really good reasonable reason to convince the court that due to a really valid factor or reason, he or she could not approach the court well within time. So doctrine of lashes says that if you are going to just take an unreasonable amount of time in approaching the court, then the court will not entertain your claim. And in India, the Limitation Act is based on the doctrine of lashes. So Limitation Act sets out a time window or a time frame for every class of case, that if this is the type of controversy involved, then you have to approach the court within this period of time. And if that time lapses, the court will not entertain your plea until and unless you have a really good reason to convince the court. Clear? Okay. If A sells his horse to B knowing that the horse is of unsound mind and B buys the horse, what type of liability will be there for A? Now Purnima, this is a case of fraud. Okay, under fraud we study this aspect where we talk about active concealment of a fact. Okay, now in this case there are two situations. One thing is we also apply the rule of caveat emptor, that even the buyer needs to be really aware before he buys a certain product or chattel. Okay, so horse is an example of a chattel. Now had A and B been in the type of equation, or had A and B shared a relationship or equation where there is a relationship of trust, okay, and faith. So when two parties, they know each other in an informal capacity, say for example you're buying a horse from your uncle, okay, then you are likely going to place this trust on him that he's not going to give you a bad deal, or if there is something wrong, something that is wrong with the horse, he is going to disclose it to you. So in this case the liability is going to be on the uncle who's selling you the horse. But if there is not this relationship of trust and faith, and if the seller actively conceals that the horse had an unsound mind, then it is going to be a void agreement and you can easily set it aside. Amit, illegal contracts are, they overlap with void contracts. So if you enter into a contract, say for example for the illegal sale of alcohol, again drugs, so these are contracts which are expressly prohibited by the law. They are against the law as well as public policy. So ultimately all illegal contracts are also void contracts. Okay, what if the seller of the horse also does not know that he's of unsound mind? Then this is going to be a case of misrepresentation. Okay, misrepresentation is a situation where you are making a statement which you think is true. Okay, in fraud, you're making a statement and you know it's not true. But in misrepresentation, you don't know that the statement that you're making is not true. But again, the status is voidable. Okay, Purnima, they're saying if the question says that B trusts A, now if they put this in the question paper, they are going to give you a relationship with that they were old friends or they were father and son or uncle and nephew, then there has to be a, then of course you will have trust and faith. But if one party decides to just be very relaxed in the approach and just decides to trust the other party, then we will apply the rule of caveat emptor, which means let the buyer be aware. So in that case, just because B decides to trust A, even though there is no relationship as such between B and A where B should be trusting A, then B will not get that benefit of setting aside the contract. Now we are going to get down to discussing what is an offer. We've discussed offer as one of the most basic elements of an agreement or a contract, because if you do not make an offer, there will be no acceptance, and there will not be a question of whether an agreement has been created or a contract has been created. Now, what are the various essentials of an offer? What are the things that the person who's making an offer has to keep in mind? Let's look at the first one. Essential is must give rise to legal consequences. Now, I've already explained to you that legal obligation has to be there. This case that I have quoted in the bracket, Balfour versus Balfour, is a situation where a husband and wife promise certain things to each other. So the husband had promised to his wife that for every month he's going to be away from the house, he is going to pay a sum of 30 pounds to the wife. Alright. So after one point of time, the husband stopped paying this amount to the wife. So the wife took up this matter in the court. So it was in this landmark case, the court came up with this decision. And remember, I had explained to you in the beginning of the session that there are these three categories in which we assume that there was no intention to create legal consequences or legal obligation. And those categories were husband and wife, blood relatives, and those people who share a relationship of natural love and affection. So in this case, the wife's claim was not allowed by the court. Then the next point on the slide is disclosure of intention is not an offer. So you must have seen in our day-to-day lives, we just tend to share a lot of information, tend to exchange viewpoints. So if A is sitting with B and A simply tells B that, you know, I'm planning to sell my car for say 5 lakh rupees, this does not mean that he is saying this to B. Had A said that, okay, you know, I want to buy my car to you for rupees 5 lakh, then it would have been an offer. But when A is simply in the flow of conversation telling B that these days I'm thinking about selling my car for rupees 5 lakh, then he's simply having a conversation and he's simply sharing his intention with B. It is not going to be a case of an offer, because the most basic element of an offer is that it should be communicated specifically to the offeree. Alright, then the next point on the slide is supply of information is not an offer. So one of the students had asked me that when A asks B two questions, that, you know, what is the price of your car and will you sell your car to me, and B only responds to the first question that, you know, the price of my car is say 2 lakh rupees, but he does not respond to the question whether he's going to sell it or not. So this case, Harvey versus Facey, it's important because it has similar facts. So one of the parties asked the other party that what is the price of your bumper hole pen and will you sell it to me? Again, two questions. So the other party responded by just quoting the lowest price of the bumper hole pen, but the party did not answer the second question whether it was willing to sell the pen or not. So in this case, it did not amount to an offer, okay, because the other party said, okay, I'm willing to buy it, but then the other party had simply supplied information, they had not made an offer. Alright, then what is the difference between a general offer and a specific offer? Now understand one thing, that when you are putting out an offer, It can be specifically for one individual. It can also be for a community or a group of individuals or for people only living in a certain city. Now, a specific offer is when A is telling B that I want to sell my car to you for rupees 10 lakh. But a general offer would be when A publishes in the newspaper that a car is available for sale in a perfectly good condition and it's been on the road for 2 years and the price is 5 lakh. Now, anybody who reads this offer can go and accept the offer. Sometimes you see offers are only for people who belong to a certain city or who live in a certain sector, or there may be an offer which is just for doctors, which is for people who are in the army, etc., etc. So you can make your offer as specific as you want, or you can make your offer as general as you want. So this case that I've quoted in the bracket, Carlyle versus Carbolic Smokeball Company, in this case, the company made an offer that if anybody after consuming the medicine we make still contracts the disease of influenza, then we are going to pay $100. Clear? So this one particular individual consumed the medicine and despite that contracted influenza. Now in this case, the company took up the pretext that we are not going to pay the money that we promised because our offer was not made to this individual. But the court said that when you advertise, okay, to the public that this is your offer, then anyone who hears the advertisement, sees the advertisement or reads the advertisement can avail the benefit. So if you remember, there was a time most of the water purifiers had come up with this ad that if after using our water purifier there's any impurity in the water, we are going to give you 1 crore rupees. Now this is an example of a general offer. Anybody who specifies these terms and conditions is going to be in a position to avail that award money. Alright Chata, if B just say and A is his relative, then is he A liable? Yes, because Chata, then it amounts to fraud because there was a relationship of faith and trust, and Dikshant has already answered that for you, right? It will amount to fraud. Then the next point on the slide is offer must be communicated. Now of course I told you that there has to be a very clear communication of offer. It should not be a supply of information or simply a disclosure of intention. You have to be very specific as to who you're making the offer to. Until and unless it's not communicated, you're not going to get an acceptance from the other side, because offer is the first and the most basic step towards the creation of an agreement or towards the creation of a contract. Terms have to be very certain. Even when we were doing the elements of a valid contract, we spoke about the certainty of terms. So when you're making the offer, you have to be very certain that, you know, this is the house that I'm willing to sell to you for this amount of money. Say for example, my flat on the third floor for rupees 15 lakh. You're not going to say my house in the building for the best market price. You might have 3 flats in the building. Now this is going to be ambiguous because the other party might think you're talking about the flat which is on the top floor. So again, there will be no meeting of minds, or there's not going to be any consensus ad idem. The next point on the slide is an invitation to offer. Now I've quoted certain examples: auction sale, tender notice, price tag. Amit, can offer be communicated with body gestures? Amit, of course, this exception is only available to people who are mute. Okay, otherwise your offer and acceptance have to be very clearly communicated. Okay, why am I giving this benefit to those who are mute? By mute, I mean people who are dumb. Okay, they can do it, and that too through people who are body language and hand movement gesture experts. Okay, otherwise it cannot be communicated through body movements, or even silence cannot amount to offer or acceptance. Can the offer, can offer be communicated? Aditya saying, can the offer be made with oral communication, and how the legal obligations? Yes, Aditya, offer can be oral or it can be written. It has to be expressed in any form. Okay, but these days we've shifted to a trend because we are living in a commercial world and everything is written and registered. So the only problem is it is difficult to prove oral agreements or oral promises at a later stage. However, the Indian Contract Act gives recognition to oral agreements as well. All right, an invitation to offer. So if you look at the slide, I've mentioned three examples here: auction sale, tender notice, or price tag. So price tag is something that you're all aware of about. When you go out to shop, you like, say for example, you like a shirt, you pick it up, you look at the price tag. Okay, now when you see that price tag, you will walk towards the cash counter, and you are the one who is going to then make an offer that you want to buy the shirt. So the person who's standing across the cash counter can even reject your offer. He might say that this piece is on hold or this piece is not for sale. So you should understand that when a price tag is put on any good, it is an invitation for you to come and make an offer. You're not the one who's accepting the offer. Instead, you are the one who's going to make an offer. Similarly, in tender notice, what happens in a tender notice is a tender is published by the government, and ultimately so tenders are floated, right? Tenders are floated. Say for example, the government says that we have to build a 100 kilometer stretch of national highway. So the parties who are interested in doing the construction for the government, they have to bid for it. So the person who is going to make the lowest bid is definitely going to make an offer. So all contractors are going to start making their bids that I am going to make this stretch in 20 crores, someone might say 30, 40. So now this tender acts like an invitation for the interested parties to come and make their bids or their offer. Secondly, auction sale is again the same thing. Say for example, there's an antique piece which is put out on display, right? So when it's put out on display and it is described, then the person who's conducting the auction or the auctioneer, he starts the bid at a certain price. Okay, he'll say that the auction starts at 5 lakh. Then people who are attending the auction, they start making their bids that they're going to buy it for 5.5 lakh or 6 lakh. Ultimately, when the auctioneer hits the hammer, he accepts the offer. So this is the difference between offer and invitation to offer. All right, let's move on to the next slide. What are the various essentials of an acceptance? Now, just like we've discussed the essential elements of an offer, now we are going to be discussing the elements of a valid acceptance. So, essentials of a valid acceptance. First of all, acceptance has to be absolute and unqualified. Now, again, I'm talking about the same aspect, because for consensus ad idem or for meeting of minds, you have to agree with the offer absolutely and in an unqualified manner. We are applying the mirror rule over here. Absolute means to accept the offer the way it is, and unqualified means you are not going to attach any additional terms and conditions, or you're not going to recommend any changes. Clear? The second point on the slide is saying acceptance should be given by a person to whom the offer is made. Bolton versus Jones is the case I'm quoting. So if A is making an offer to B, then B has to accept the offer either himself, or there has to be an authorized agent appointed by B to make that acceptance. If instead of B, C accepts the offer and C is also not an authorized agent, then in that case, the acceptance will not be complete. So in Bolton versus Jones, what happened? There were three parties that were involved. Now, there was an owner of a business, and he sold his business to his manager. And then there was a third party which used to consistently order goods from the original owner of the business. So when he sent in his next order, he was not aware that the original owner had sold his business to the manager. Now, when the manager supplied the goods to the customer refused to pay the new owner, because the customer said that he had basically made an offer to the original owner and not to the new owner. So that is why acceptance only has to be given by the person to whom the offer is made. Okay, Dikshant, I'm reading the question. Rubaiya proposes to sell her beautiful brown mare to Fatima for rupees 2 lakh. She communicates her proposal through a letter dated. Alright, Dikshant, I'm getting to communication by post, so you'll have to wait till then. Silence does not amount to acceptance. Now, silence cannot amount to acceptance ever. Feldhaus versus Bindley is a landmark judgment on this issue. In this case, what happened is an uncle wrote to his nephew, and the nephew had a business of buying and selling of horses which were of a good breed. So the uncle told his nephew that I am interested in buying a certain horse, and if you don't reply to me, I will consider that as a yes. That means I will consider that you have accepted the offer. So the nephew, just like his uncle had asked him, he did not communicate his acceptance to the uncle. In the meanwhile, what happened is the nephew's manager, okay, he sold that particular horse to a third party. Now, the uncle filed a case against the nephew. So in this case, the court said that even though the uncle and the nephew had decided that if the nephew will not respond, it will amount to a yes or it will amount to acceptance, but legally silence can never amount to acceptance. Your acceptance must be communicated in absolutely clear cut terms. Alright, should be given within a reasonable time. Okay, now sometimes the offer specifies that if you are interested in the offer, if you are interested in buying the house, or if you are interested in joining a certain job, you must respond within 14 days or within a month. So you must accept the offer within that stipulated time, right? If you're not going to accept the offer in that stipulated time, the offer will lapse. You must have seen in the newspaper, lots of offers are published. There's going to be a 70% sale, but it's only going to be there till 31st of March. Now, they have made an offer to you. If you do not go and avail that discount before 31st March, the offer will lapse. Mode of communication. Also, sometimes you might be specified that, okay, if you are accepting the job offer, kindly send us a registered post through the Indian Postal Service. Okay, so then in that case, if you make a phone call and say I am ready to work with you, or if you write them an email, then your acceptance will not have any validity, because you were specifically told that if you are making an acceptance, do it through a registered letter, that also through an through the Indian Postal Services. Clear? Hina, acceptance can be oral if the other party is okay with it. But if the other party has specified that you have to give your acceptance in writing, then the acceptance has to be in writing. So there are no straitjacket or clear-cut rules as far as this is concerned. The point is you have to make your acceptance in the same manner in which the party that made the offer has specified to you. Contract by post. Okay, Dikshant, so I'm going to tell you a few basic rules pertaining to contract by post. Hopefully, this is going to answer your question. Now, as far as offer is concerned, now a contract by post held a lot of relevance because we are talking about an act which was formulated in 1872, right? So, we are going to discuss how offer is complete when you are communicating by post. So, if A is writing a letter to B, when is offer going to be complete? Offer is going to be complete when the letter reaches B. Okay, please focus on this. Now, once B has received the letter, his job is to either reject the offer or accept the offer. Now, in this case, B now writes a letter to A. And he has to communicate to A that he is accepting the offer. Now, as far as the offer was concerned, it was only going to be complete after it has reached B. But as far as acceptance is concerned, it's going to become complete as soon as B posts it, irrespective of whether the letter reaches A or not. Clear? Is this clear? Because this is the one aspect on which you can be tested in your law entrances, that offers complete, common sense, once it reaches B. But when is acceptance complete? Your common sense says once the letter of acceptance reaches A. But this is the hitch, this is the twist here, that the letter of acceptance becomes complete the minute it reaches, the minute it is posted by B. Now, how can you revoke your offer or how can you revoke your acceptance? Now, revocation of offer means when A writes a letter to B and he is accepting the offer, right? So, he has to make sure that his letter of cancellation of offer reaches the letter of actual offer before. Okay, my point is, whenever revocation of offer has to be made, the person has to make sure that his letter of cancellation of offer reaches before the letter of original offer reaches. Similarly, the rule remains the same for acceptance. If B wants to cancel his acceptance that he's made to A, he'll have to make sure that his letter of cancellation of acceptance reaches before the original letter of acceptance. The next point is consideration. Now, consideration is again a very valid element as far as a valid contract is concerned. But before I proceed, I'd like to know if there are any queries pertaining to whatever we've covered up until this point. Aditya, can you please repeat your question? But in Feldhaus versus Bindley case, it's a blood relation. So it does not consist of any legal obligation. We are not talking about legal obligation here, Aditya. The point we are covering is, can silence amount to acceptance? So here the question was, when the nephew did not reply, will it amount to acceptance or not? So that is the question we are covering. What if there are two consecutive emails, if first is offer and second is revocation, will the offer be unacceptable? See, when you are trying to revoke your offer, you have to make sure that your revocation reaches before the offer. And in the situation where revocation and offer reach at the same time, in that case, revocation is going to preside. Okay, there can also be a situation that your letter of acceptance and your letter of revocation of acceptance reach at the same time. So at that time, the law will consider revocation. Privity of contract, Dikshant, means that when two parties enter into a contract, so in case one of the parties does not fulfill the contract, then only those parties who signed the contract can approach the court. A third party cannot approach the court. This is what you mean by privity of contract. Jobanpreet, unsoundness of mind means any person who is insane. Okay, any person who's insane does not have a sound mind. And if he enters into a contract, okay, it's going to be void. It does not have any existence in the eyes of law. However, there can be a situation where a person is usually of a sound mind but suffers from unsound intervals, okay, also has these phases where he has an unsound mind. So the contract he entered into during that sound interval, okay, when he was sane, when he understood what he was doing, that is going to be valid. But if he entered into a contract during his unsound interval, then it is going to be a void or invalid contract. Okay, Purnima is saying, A offers to sell his house to B. B accepts the offer and writes the acceptance letter but thinks to post it. But the next day, A's revocation letter comes. So, right, B has not posted it yet, right? And the revocation letter has reached. So, before B could accept the offer, A has revoked. So, it is going to be a case of a contract which has been set aside or which has been revoked. Jobanpreet, burden of proof is something that we specifically need to study under IPC, but as far as contract is concerned, any party which is trying to prove in court that the other party has not fulfilled their part of the promise, the burden of proof is on them because they have to say that these were the terms and conditions of the contract and the other party has not fulfilled the contract. So, burden of proof is usually on the party which is making a claim. If B had posted the letter, Shraddha, in Purnima's question, then it would have been an acceptance and then the contract would have become a binding one. In which case, Joban, can you please give me some more clarity? Are you looking for an example or you want me to or you have a specific question in mind as far as unsoundness is concerned. Jobin, you'll have to take me back to the question. What is your question? Sumit, the rule of estoppel basically says that when you've said something or when you've done something, and because of the fact that you said a certain thing or you did a certain thing, the other person reacted to it. That means if you claim that, you know, a certain piece of land is extremely fertile and you plan to buy a piece of land because you want to ultimately grow mango trees, or you want to grow a mango orchard over there. So here the fact whether the land is fertile or not is really relevant, right? So estoppel would mean that if somebody ended up buying that piece of land just because you said that the land is really fertile, later on you will not be able to deny that you did not say that thing, or you were just simply stating a fact which was not true. Estoppel, in very general terms, means that you can't go back on your words. So promissory estoppel is when you have said something, okay, in your promise, which made the other person believe something, okay, and he acted on that belief, then you can't go back on your words. Yes, Dikshant Johar, that is what I mean by privity of contract, that when, if you are not a party to a contract, you can't bring a claim, you can't approach the court, and you can enjoy the benefit as far as privity of contract is concerned, okay? A contract may be entered for the benefit of a third party, so I don't agree with it, alright? Privity of contract specifically focuses on the fact that only those parties who've entered into a contract can ensure that the contract is fulfilled. A contract can definitely be entered for the benefit or for the profit of a third party. Alright? Dikshant, I'm reading your question. The doctrine of privity is to the effect that a person who is not a party to a contract cannot enjoy the benefits or suffer the burdens of that contract. B. In the law of trust, the doctrine of privity has no application. A person in whose favor a trust is created can directly enforce his right, even though he was not a party to the contract. Tej and Samir enter into a contract whereby the... Dikshant, I know the point behind this case, and I am going to quote another example for you. A and B entered into a contract. Say, for example, A transferred his share of property to B and said that B in return has to pay a certain amount of money to C every month. Now, when B stops doing that, C, which is the beneficiary of that contract, can file a case against B. Now, in this case, B can't say that C was not a party to the contract, because in this case, C was benefiting from the contract. So, privity of contract means when the parties to the contract can only make sure that the contract is fulfilled. But when we talk about the beneficiary of a contract, this is where we also discuss the aspect of consideration. Consideration can come from a third party also. So in this case, consideration has come from a third party. Jobin, as far as unsoundness of mind is concerned, the party on the other side, that is the party which entered into a contract, it will depend on the facts and circumstances of the case. In case the person who entered into a contract and who has an unsound mind, he does not fulfill his contract, then he is going to prove that he has an unsound mind. Okay, and the situation can also be vice versa. So there is no clear-cut responsibility as far as burden of proof is concerned under the law of contract. Yes, Shraddha, the answer is going to be C. Alright, now moving on to the part consideration. What is the relevance of consideration and how is it a really important element of a valid contract? Jobinpreet, trespass to land. We are going to do this under torts, okay? We are not going to be covering it under contract. Now, in this example that you see on the slide, A is willing to sell his house to B for an amount of rupees 25 lakh. Now, in this case, what is happening is that consideration is the house as far as B is concerned. And for A, the consideration is going to be 25 lakh, which is going to be paid by B. Now, I've told you consideration means something of value which is given by both the parties. So the house and the money is how something of value is exchanged between A and B. Important here is there has to be value addition on both sides, because I told you a while back that until and unless there is not value addition on both the sides, you can't call it a contract. If only one party is benefiting from the contract, then it is going to be either a gift or a charity. So whenever you enter into a contract, you have to ask yourself this question, that what is in it for me? How am I going to benefit from it? Or what is going to be my profit or my gain? So if an employer and employee sign a contract, the employee is going to get money. Okay, that is the value addition for the employee. And for the employer, the point is he gets the skill, or he gets the services and the time and whatever skill that the employee has. So that is his value addition. The employee ends up getting a good resource as far as his organization is concerned. So both the parties must benefit. So parties have to subconsciously or consciously ask this question, that how will they benefit, or what is in it for them specifically when we are deciding the question of consideration. Sahil, I am going to be continuing with the leftover part of contract, and then I am going to start with the most important topics under the law of torts. Shraddha, the answer is C. Okay, simultaneous benefit and detriment for both. So look, if you take a look at the previous example where A is selling his house to B, so the detriment or loss for him is that he is giving his house, but at the same time there is also value addition because he is getting 25 lakh in return. Similarly for B, the value addition is he is going to get the house, and the value detriment is 25 lakh that he is giving away. Consideration should be something of value which can be objectively determined. Now, consideration has to be something of value. When I explain this point, it is pertinent to point out that consideration's adequacy cannot be questioned. So, if I want to sell my house which is worth 10 crore for 10 lakh, nobody can question that, because we are only talking about some type of objective consideration, which means a certain value addition which is very easily determined, or you can comprehend that what is the value addition easily. Benefit that each party gets or expects to get is consideration. Yes, Shraddha, I am going to be taking a session on the forthcoming topics next Wednesday. So tomorrow you will of course be having classes on verbal and analogy. So next week you'll have a session with me on Wednesday and Thursday in the same time slots. So consideration can be in the following forms. You have money. Okay, when A sells his car for rupees 5 lakh, this is money. Promise to do something. When A basically says that he is going to paint somebody's house for rupees 5,000, this action of painting amounts to consideration for the other party. Then when A asks his neighbor not to build a road next to the fence, so A might say that do not build a road next to my fence, in return of that I am going to pay you 50,000 rupees. So here B's promise to not build that road has value for A, right? And all of this can be done in the past, present or future. Aditya, is there any contract for charity such that the charitable object is protected with the person who has received the object? Aditya, I'll need some more clarity on this question from you. Ma'am, what is the essential difference between fraud and misrepresentation? Dikshant, in fraud, you know that you are making an untrue statement, okay? You know that you are lying, you are stating a fact which is not true. I mean, you're projecting a certain statement to be fact. Facts are true. But in misrepresentation, you are saying something which is not true, but you genuinely believe that it's a true statement. Say, for example, you genuinely feel that the camera has been manufactured in America. Okay? And you sell it to another party. Later on, you find out that the camera was actually manufactured in China. So this is a case of misrepresentation, because when you made that statement that the camera has been manufactured in America, you were making a truthful statement from your end. So the main difference between fraud and misrepresentation is that of intention. In fraud, your intention is wrong or bad or malified. However, in misrepresentation, your intention is good or bona fide. You do not intend to deceive the other party. Jovanpreet, on the student dashboard, we have 5 sets which we've dedicated to legal terms and axioms. Every set consists of 20 questions. So there are a total of 100 questions as far as legal terms and axioms are concerned. So that should be enough material for you as far as preparation of terms and axioms is concerned. Alright? Okay, before I proceed, any more questions? Yes, Choban, in your account. Alright? They'll be in your account. Test pertaining to legal terms and axioms, a total of 5. Every test has 20 questions. Please put in your queries related to law of contract. Okay, so as far as free consent is concerned, it is something that I'll be taking up in detail in the next session. And I'll also be dealing with quasi contracts, and I'll be dealing with the contract of bailment in the forthcoming session, that is next Wednesday. And from there on, we will also start our discussion on the law of torts. Yes, Dikshant. Passive deceit, lack of motive, scale of operation. Dikshant, you'll have to relate it to the question that you'd asked. If A agrees to marry after asking B and C, and if not, he will pay them 5,000. But when A wants to marry, B and C are abroad. So he marries without telling them and tells them once they've come back. Is A liable for paying B and C? See, in this case, this is an agreement which is a restraint on marriage. And there are 3 types of contracts which have specifically been held illegal or unlawful. Okay, and one of them is restraint on marriage. So if a restraint has been put on A that he cannot get married until and unless he takes permission from B and C, this amounts to a restraint on marriage. So even if A gets married without seeking the permission of B and C, then he is not liable to pay that amount. Alright? Passive deceit, scale of operation, lack of motive. Dikshant, you're talking about fraud and misrepresentation. See, fraud is passive deceit. Lack of motive is misrepresentation. Scale of operation is a very vague term. So I would want to know the entire question that you're picking up from whatever source, because this question is not giving me any clarity. So I'm sorry, I'm not going to be able to help you with it. Shraddha, the essential difference between fraud and misrepresentation is the difference in motive. Alright, the motives have to be different. In fraud, your motive or your intention is to deceive. In misrepresentation, your intention is not to deceive. In misrepresentation, from your own end, you're making an honest or a genuine statement. But in fraud, you're making a dishonest statement and you know it. Shraddha, answer to what? Passive deceit, lack of motive, scale of operation. These are options to what? That is what I'm asking you. So students, I'm going to be continuing with, like I told you, free consent. And then we'll move on to quasi contract and the contract of bailment in the next session. Next session itself, once we are done with this, we are also going to be talking about law of torts. Alright? What is the essential difference between fraud and misrepresentation? Well, now I have clarity. All of the above. Okay? You can differentiate fraud and misrepresentation based on all these 3 options. Passive deceit, lack of motive and scale of operation. Alright, now I have clarity. All of the above is going to be the answer. That is the 4th option. Is it clear? Alright, great. Thank you so much again for your time and attention. And I'm going to see you next week. And we'll discuss contract and torts in the forthcoming week. Keep preparing and keep a very positive mindset. Thank you very much.